lovely blue eyes, which is where he got his blue eyes from.
Was your memory of this room being used as an entertainment space in the evenings, so people
absolutely
have drinks here?
I can practically see them. I remember one particular party was for Marilyn Monroe, because she was here to make the film Prince and the Showgirl, Laurence Olivier.
Yes.
And so it had everybody and his wife, if you ever heard of, in the theatre world. It was a great party. And she'd just got married to Arthur Miller. And so she was trying to be very, rather live up to his intellectual image, it was sweet. Very touching.
It feels like it was a happy place. Was it a happy place?
Very happy. And it really was. People longed to be asked, and they loved it when they came and so on. And it was always fun.
Jean's relationships with various boyfriends were of constant interest to Rattingen, and some of her experiences inspired his female characters.
That is fantastic.
Most relationships are so complicated. One's more keen on the other, or
yes,
one's not sure of themselves with the other, whatever it is.
And did you share that in conversation with
Terence? Oh, yes, and we would analyse it all. Oh, what a woman feels, all the time. He'd just always ask me, what did he say? You know, if I had an argument with a boyfriend, what did he say that made you so cross, or that you made him so cross? And I could tell him anything, and we would talk about every situation. He'd understand. It was lovely. It was like going to a father confessor.
You must have seemed like the perfect couple. I imagine you probably never had arguments or...
Well, it didn't. We were so happy. I mean, really, if one could have a relationship like that, it would
ideal.
Be lovely. Yeah. You know, he was, homosexual. And, of course, now it's quite natural, but those days it was not at all considered natural, and they put people in prison, can you imagine?
Horrendous.
I mean, it's unbelievable. Yeah. But it did cause that people had to sort of, you know, turn the other way as if you didn't know. And that's why I often wonder if his mother knew about it.
Mm.
I honestly didn't know whether she refused to admit it or didn't know, because sometimes people were very innocent then, and they didn't.
Cigarettes, holding hands and yawning, look how late it gets. Two sleepy people by dawn's early light, and too much in love to say goodnight.
Visiting Rattigan's house in the Berkshire countryside and chatting to Jean has given me a real sense of his lifestyle in the early 50s. He obviously spent lots of time writing here, but also knew how to enjoy himself. And it seems his diary was pretty full of socializing and parties. But as Jean told me, behind the public persona, there were secrets. He had to keep his intimate relationships private.
Hello, Benedict, you found your way.
Good afternoon.
It's good to see you.
Lovely to meet you.
Come in and we'll have a little talk in the saloon, which is down.
One of Rattigan's partners at this time was Adrian Brown. Adrian started a six-year relationship with the 44-year-old Rattigan when he was just 22. I asked him how difficult it was to keep an affair like theirs secret.
Well, it wasn't hard if you were gay, because there were all sorts of private societies and private clubs and private this sort of thing. It was really great fun, to tell you the truth. It was that no one must know about it, because it wouldn't be nice, and everybody had to be nice.
And did you ever meet Vera Rattigan? Did you ever meet his mother?
No, I never met her at all.
Really?
I had quite expected that tea parties would take place and that sort of thing, but they never did. And so I never met the good lady or did any of his other chums, because Mother then might discover that he was not quite nice. You see, he had these strange proclivities, and Mother must be protected at all costs.
The man of great sophistication and ease and bon vivre and the wit, the person who is comfortable in his skin in public, but was he at all different in private?
No, not really. He was always very witty and always very well dressed and had a good tournure de phrase, you know. He could bring back a repartee to any question. It was this, and then the cigarette would be held out there until he was ready to smoke it again, you see. And then there would usually be a gin and tonic in the other hand.
Dosing with both hands all the time.
Yes.
The social butterfly image of Rattigan is certainly in keeping with his desire to entertain within his plays. However, he was not content to purely be a Noel Coward figure. There was another side to him, which wanted to be seen as a serious dramatist.
prefer to be thought of the undertones and the sub-writing, the subtext writing that he could do in the Chekhovian manner. He was not quite as good as the comedies as Noel Coward was, but he was better at the serious plays than Noel Coward was, you see. So, no, he valued himself on the serious plays like the Winslow Boy and the Browning version. Those were where he thought he was going.
I'm sitting on top of the world, just rolling along, just rolling along.
Alongside Noel Coward, Rattingan was fast becoming one of the UK's leading playwrights. At the time, the theatre establishment was run by a small group of men, an elite group, and at the head of that was a man called Binky Beaumont, a theatre manager of notorious influence and power.
He was the puppet master of the West End, controlling exactly which productions would get the go-ahead. He was homosexual, and his preference for working with other homosexuals was notorious. If you didn't fit into Binky's set, you had no chance in the West End. He would have a big influence on Rattigan's fate.
He was said to be suave, sophisticated, incredibly well-dressed and well-mannered, with a smile always on his face, even at his most ruthless.
With his background and his success, Rattingan fitted naturally into Binky's set. And although he wanted to be considered as a serious playwright, he wrote a controversial article in 1950 which linked him even more closely with the entertainment-driven commercial theatre of Binky Beaumont. There was a long tradition in British theatre going back to Bernard Shaw of writing plays which engaged with social issues. But in his article, Rattingan attacked what he called the play of ideas for being too concerned with contemporary problems.
Rattingan says, "I don't think that ideas per se, social, political or moral, have a very important place in theatre. They definitely take third place to character and narrative anyway." And then the bit that got him into real trouble. "The trouble with theatre today is not that so few writers refuse to look the facts of the present world in the face, but that so many refuse to look at anything else." The critical storm that joined this article was quite unprecedented. He became identified with safe, conservative, commercial choices in the theatre world.
And the commercial theatre of the time was still restricted in what it could show. All plays had to be approved by the Lord Chamberlain, effectively a censor, before they could be performed. In 1952, Rattingan wrote a play inspired by the suicide of one of his lovers, Kenneth Morgan, called The Deep Blue Sea. It's believed the earliest drafts focused on a failed homosexual relationship, but this would never have been accepted. The final version, with a heterosexual couple, was a huge West End success. Deep Blue Sea ran for 500 performances, and Rattingan wrote the screenplay for the film starring Vivian Leigh and Kenneth Moore.
Mr. Rattingan, you wrote the stage play and the screenplay, and how do you think it compares?
Well, that's a very difficult question to answer. As the author of the play, I would like to say that I enjoy the film very much. I think the film is a really wonderful film.
Thank you.
I think I'm entitled to say that as the author of the play, please.
Very good.
The Deep Blue Sea's main character is Hester. Driven by passion, she leaves her upper-class husband to live with a younger man. But when he decides to leave, her fragile new world starts to crumble.
Yes, this is our last chance. We're death to each other, you and I.
It's not true.
It is true, darling, and you've known it longer than I have.
I haven't finished
them. Well, they're all right. Oh, I'm sorry, Hess. Oh, I'm sorry. Please don't cry. You don't know what it does to me. I've got to get out of here.
Not now. Not this minute, Penny. Not just this minute. You've got all your things here.
You've got to send for them.
But you promise you'll be in for dinner. You can't.
I know, I'm sorry about
that. I swear I won't now. You don't leave me alone, Penny. Don't leave me alone tonight. Not tonight, Penny. Not tonight. Come back, Penny. Don't go, Penny. Don't go, Penny. Penny, don't leave me alone tonight.
As part of the wide revival of Rattigan's work happening at the moment, a new feature film of The Deep Blue Sea is being produced. I've come to a sound studio in Soho, London, where the film's director, Terence Davis, is adding the finishing touches to the sound.
Occasionally. I just find...
He's going to let me have a rare sneak peek at it.
Beware of passion, Hester. It always leads to something ugly. What would you replace it with? A guarded enthusiasm.
My first experience of the play was when I went to see it at the Armada, and it was a school outing, and it was the most extraordinary experience, and I'd say one of the main reasons that eventually persuaded me to take this nonsense profession up for good and really have a go at being an actor. And I'm fascinated to know what drew you to the Deep Blue Sea as potential for a film.
Well, it came out of the blue. I didn't really know it. Sean O'Connor, one of the producers, got in touch with him and said, would I like to do a Rattingan? I said, well, the only one I remembered was The Deep Blue Sea. And so I said, well, you know, I'll read it. You know, and at first I was very worried because I didn't really know what it was about subtextually.
Mm.
So I read it two or three more times and I thought, I know what it's about now. It's about love. The nature of love, of one person wanting a kind of love from the other person, which the other person can't give. Well, of course, that's, once you know what the meaning of it, I said, yes, I'll do it. Why I was drawn to it was that here is someone who's actually very conventional and has married probably for companionship and not sexuality, because, you know, Collier was a nice man. And then she finds sex, she finds eroticism and sex, and that's so powerful that it consumes her. She leaves her husband and goes and live with a man that you did not do in the 50s. What's she going to do? How's she going to live? And she takes that risk without actually thinking about the risk. That's what's extraordinary, that you can be overwhelmed by this emotion called love. But I also suppose what I did respond to deeply is the fact that she's an outsider, and I feel like an outsider, always have done. Even though I'm the youngest of 10 children, I've always felt as though I've been on the outside looking in at life. Other people participate in life, and I seem to always just look at it. And that's what I liked about it as well.
Rattingan, too, was undoubtedly an outsider. Although he was hugely successful and mixed in all the right circles, he was an onlooker of life. Unable to be open about his homosexuality in his private life or directly express it in his work. In 1953, following the critical success of The Deep Blue Sea, Rattingan wrote a much lighter affair, The Sleeping Prince. Despite being commercially successful, it disappointed the critics. Rattingan was becoming highly sensitive to their criticism and used a preface to a new collection of his works to argue that just because his plays were commercially successful, there was no reason not to take them seriously. To help his argument, he invented a comic character called Aunt Edna, an aging lady theatre-goer living in a Kensington hotel.
Now, Aunt Edna does not appreciate Kafka. So obscure, my dear, why always look at the dark side of things? She's upset by Picasso. Those dreadful reds, my dear. And why three noses? And she's against Walton. Such appalling discords, my dear. No melody at all. She's, in short, a hopeless lowbrow, and the great novelist, the master painter, and the composer of genius are, and can afford to be, as disregarding of her tastes as she is unappreciative of their works. Not so, unhappily, the playwright. For should he displease Aunt Edna, he is utterly lost. Oh, it was so dull, my dears. Don't think of going to it all. So much talk, so little action, so difficult to see the actors' faces. And even the tea was cold.
Ooh. Aunt Edna was intended as a light-hearted creation, but she quickly came to be seen as synonymous with Rattingan himself. Yet again, Rattingan had helped to pigeonhole himself as belonging to a rather old-fashioned, light, commercial theatre. A spectacular own goal. But in his next play, Rattingan would once again display his more serious side. Separate Tables. Separate Tables explored the difficulties of honest sexual expression. It opened in 1954, and 2 years later was made into an award-winning film. One of the central characters played in the film by David Niven is the Major.
I rather think you mean a lot to her.
He's uncovered as a fraud who has been arrested for molesting women in a local cinema.
You know, one's awfully apt to try and excuse oneself sometimes by saying, well, what I do doesn't do anybody else much harm. but one does, you see. It's not a thought that I like very much. Well, mustn't miss the old train, what?
In Rattigan's original script, the Major's offence was a homosexual one. But again, Rattigan toned it down to avoid the Lord Chamberlain's blue pencil and appeal to a mainstream audience. Paranoia about homosexuality had re-emerged with a vengeance after the Second World War and the beginning of the Cold War. And there was a concerted drive against male vice, with a huge increase in arrests.
The early 1950s were characterized by a series of notorious homosexual scandals. The rich and the famous became targets, including Sir John Gielgud, the foremost classical actor of his generation, who was arrested for gross indecency. His court appearance and arrest caused a sensation in the tabloid press, and the exposure risked both his reputation and his career. The judge fined him £10 and told him to see a doctor.
With such stories hitting the press, it was understandable that Rattigan should feel constrained about addressing homosexuality in his work. But by 1956, the social mood in Britain was changing. And ironically, a more overt theatre was emerging, but outside the commercial theatre of the West End. Here at the Royal Court in Sloane Square, a man called George Devine was encouraging a new generation of young writers and directors who hated the middle-brow, middle-class theatre of Binky Beaumont. Rattigan could hardly have imagined what effect an evening trip to a new play at this theatre would have on his future career.
Rattigan had an apartment here in Eaton Square, so he didn't have far to travel on the night of the 8th of May 1956 to Sloane Square to attend the world premiere of Look Back in Anger, a play by very young new talent John Osborne. It was a night that was to mark the beginning of Rattigan's fall from grace, and it would be many years until one of his plays was applauded in London theatre again.
Not for nothing would John Osborne and the other writers here at the Royal Court become known as the Angry Young Men, as Rattigan was about to find out.
Thank you.
Osborne's play was the catalyst for their new movement.
If only something, something would happen to you! Wake you up out of your beauty sleep! If you could have a child and it would die, let it grow! Let a recognizable human face emerge from that little mass of India rubber wrinkles. Please, now please! If only I could watch you face that! I wondered if you might even become a recognizable human being yourself, but I doubt it!
In the central character of Look Back in Anger, Jimmy Porter, a new generation had found its voice.
There's somebody going crazy here. Don't want to hear them.
I feel the weather is changing. You're growing colder.
To them, Rattigan and his ilk represented what one of them would call the pale side of the establishment, an establishment they intended to sweep away.
Rattigan came to the Royal Court for the opening night of Look Back in Anger with Binky Beaumont, who had to practically restrain him in his seat to stop him from leaving early. When the play did finish, he stepped outside and was asked for his opinion by a journalist, to which he flippantly replied, "It seemed to him that John Osborne was saying, 'Look, Ma, I'm not Terence Rattigan.'" This glib response proved him dangerously out of touch with the younger generation, and it was seized upon by the press to begin a very damaging contrast between him and the younger generation of writers.
Playwright David Hare was the resident dramatist here at the Royal Court in the early 70s. Though inspired to become a writer by the Angry Young Men, he has a more complicated attitude to Rattigan, whilst respecting some of his work as a playwright.
The two greatest plays, in my view, are the Browning version, which I think is a masterpiece, and The Deep Blue Sea, which I think is also a masterpiece. There are also some very, very good plays, like The Winslow Boy and Separate Tables, which are very good plays. But his subject in those great plays is so harrowing, and I would take Rattigan's true subject to be the impossibility of escaping who you are. You're born with a character, which is your fate, your destiny, and you can struggle, but you can't escape. It's a Greek theme.
What do you think were the reasons that he fell out of favour?
It wasn't so much that Rattingan was out of favour with the British theatre, as that he'd written most of his best work. In my opinion, he wrote most of his best work by the time the Royal Court came along and different kinds of writers appeared in the British theatre. You know, the Royal Court represented an attempt to put plays into the repertory which were not necessarily about mainstream middle-class subjects, but which were about the rest of the population. The country's changing, and the theatre's changing with it. And when it happens, it's so both invigorating to Rattingan and threatening to him at the same time.
Rattingan's next play, Variation on a Theme, was slated by reviewers.
Any play I wrote was going to get smashed. I had no chance with anything. They just didn't say why they didn't like it. They just said that it must be bad because it is old feet, it's the old theatre.
Rattingan didn't do himself any favours by painting himself as a martyr. But even so, the critics were ferocious, and one of those, Benedict Nightingale, now thinks that they went too far.
I saw Look Back in Anger, and I was very influenced by that. Well, I put on my suede shoes and my drainpipe trousers, saw Look Back in Anger, and to me at that time, Terence Rattingen represented everything that was reactionary, and because of the invention of Aunt Edna, a bit Philistine too. I feel I was wrong. I saw only one side of him. I think an awful lot of us did. But he categorised himself as someone who was anti the zeitgeist of the time, anti the social drama that was so important at the time.
No money, forget the money.
Feeling rejected by the theatre world, Rattingan spent much of the 60s abroad, living in Bermuda and spending time in Hollywood. He wrote many successful screenplays for television and film, including The VIPs and The Yellow Rolls Royce. But for me, it was a period where Rattingan's quality of writing dropped. Softened by sponges and sycophants and stagnating by retreating into this old world, he remained very out of keeping with the times. Nightingale's reviews of the plays of this time would often get a reply from Rattingan.
He wrote me quite a few letters, but then at that time he was writing everyone letters. I think he stayed up very late at night. I think he drank quite a lot. I think he was deeply unhappy and alienated and felt an awful failure and hated himself for all sorts of reasons. And what he could do was simply scrawl and write. I mean, here are some of the, frankly, scrawls, and they're rather incoherent at times.
This is a postcard that Rattingan sent you from his home in Bermuda, so it must have been quite late on, I think, January the 24th, but not a year. And it says, "Dear Benedict Nightingale, I must seize a wobbly pen to thank you for a notice that has given me more pleasure and pride than any that I can remember. I'm afraid it's my own fault. I damned myself by that idiotic invention in a hastily written preface 22 years ago of Aunt Edna. I've never been allowed to bury the old bitch or even explain more seriously what I meant by her, in brackets, something like Shakespeare's groundlings who have to be satisfied. It doesn't matter. No regrets. Thank you again, deeply, Terence Rattingen." It's a terribly moving admission of a failing.
Yeah, things got very difficult for him, but his desperation is what shows through. Yeah. That's what I find distressing, actually. He was desperate for acknowledgement. I mean, I think much more than any other playwright I know. He thought they were probably right about him. He thought he was a failure. And my God, he was not a failure.
Rattingan's health deteriorated throughout the 60s. It wasn't clear what illness he had, but it can't have been helped by his heavy drinking. But in 1971, Rattingan returned to England to receive a knighthood in the Queen's Birthday Honours List. He was only the second playwright to receive such an honour since the First World War, the first being Noel Coward. A year later, he was diagnosed with leukemia. He was dying when he wrote his final play, Cause Celeb.
Cause Celeb was based on a real-life scandal that happened in 1935. Alma Rattenbury, the wife of a retired architect, began an affair with their 18-year-old chauffeur. The chauffeur, in a fit of jealousy and pique, bludgeoned the husband to death with a mallet. Both were charged with his murder and tried at the Old Bailey. And you can see from newspaper articles at the time that the trial caused quite a sensation, with the public crying out for this scarlet woman's blood.
I remember the case well.
I was about 24, and I remember having violent arguments with my family about it. Of course, naturally, both my mother and father hated her as a symbol of everything that was dreadful in life. But I, as a budding dramatist, I thought that, well, she had a case.
Oh, very good.
Well, I'm not quite Fred Astaire.
No, not much ginger water.
Oh, I just want to go on and on like this. I want to go on and on like this till the end of the world.
I asked Thea Sharrock, the director of the recent hit production of Cause Celeb at London's Old Vic, why Rattingan chose Alma's scandal in the 30s for a play performed in the 70s.
She was turned into a monster almost by the media because people couldn't believe that a woman could behave in the way that she did. And yet in 1977, she must have felt so normal. And again, now she feels even more normal. And so yet again, he's kind of put his finger on the pulse and managed to track down a particular character.
And show the relevance across time.
Exactly.
Mrs. Davenport, I understand from the jury bailiff that you wish to be excused jury service on the grounds of conscience.
Yes, my lord. From this particular jury on this particular case.
Interwoven with Alma's story is the fictitious Edith Davenport.
No.
A sexually repressed woman thought to be based on Rattigan's own mother.
Into the matter.
I have a deep prejudice against that woman.
There's something really interesting about his last play managing to kind of wrap up the big themes of love and sex and marriage, and somehow he's managed to put his own mother right in the heart of it. There's something really arresting about that.
Rattingan attended the opening night of his final play. He was there to hear the applause as Cause Celeb was acclaimed by both the critics and the public. After 20 years in the wilderness, Rattigan's reputation was finally on the turn.
It feels very, very gratifying. And it's also something I didn't think would happen to me. I'd always thought they had been a bit unfair to me. And I always thought that justice would one day be done.
Only weeks after Cause Celeb opened, Sir Terence Rattingen died. He was 66. It's been fascinating finding out more about Rattingan, a man who was a social insider yet always an emotional outsider. The intolerance and prejudice of society forced him to hide his own sexuality. Many of his characters in his work have to live with their own inability to express themselves, creating a powerful tension at the heart of his plays. And yet I see his work as a plea for openness and honesty.
One of Rattigan's ambitions was to write plays that would be remembered 50 years on. And in this, his centenary year, he certainly achieved that. He was a master of human emotion, and he wrote plays that contained themes which were relevant universally to all human relationships. And I think it's that that truly makes him a great playwright, and someone who's revered even today, 100 years after his birth.